Okay, welcome back everybody, and in case wherever you are, I hope it's not snowing as much as it is in Sudbury. We have been blessed with 25 centimeters of snowfall, and for those of you who made it to class, which is Marianne, Jesse, and Courtney, congratulations. It must have been quite the effort. So if anyone can't hear me, let me know. I've been playing around with a couple of different microphones. So if you can hear me, that's great. You don't have to say anything. But if you don't hear me, but you're seeing my mouth move, can't hear, just send a text message. If I don't hear anything, I'm assuming things are good. One of the things that I wanted to talk to you about, we'll just review longitudinal study in a second, but more importantly, what I want to talk to you about is Monday, we will finish class a few minutes early to allow a guest speaker to come in. Her name is, let's make sure this works, her name is Melanie Lefive. And the reason Melanie is coming in is that she is the coordinator of what's called the Navigator Program. At a local college here called Cambrian College. Now, Cambrian College and Laurentian / Huntington have an agreement that if you wish to take the Navigator Program, you get a whole bunch of credits, and Melanie can come and explain the details to you so I don't butcher everything that she has to say or say wrong things. But basically, the Navigator Program deals with understanding how the medical system works, how the care system works for older adults. So if you're a gerontology student, even if you're a student, we don't teach you systems here in any of our courses. We try to teach you the Long-Term Care Act in your fourth year course. We try to walk you through some of the systems, but really if someone told you, hey, I need to get A, B, and C for my grandpa, how do I do it? I don't think we're properly equipped to do that component, just understanding systems. So the Navigator Program is very important because what Melanie will talk to you about is how that program, it's a one-year diploma, and if, I don't know how much time it ends up being once you get a whole bunch of credits from our program. It's definitely not as long as if you went into it without the gerontology degree. But that's something that you can think about in terms of options for you moving forward, unless you already have a job lined up. If you're thinking of what do I do next with my undergraduate degree, this is a great program to get into because people need systems navigators. These are the people that get hired at what used to be known as the LHINs, the Home Care Access Centers, because you already know the system. It's easier for you to walk into an interview and say, well, yeah, great. Thank you for offering to train me. I will use your training, but this is what I already have, right? So it makes you a more appealing candidate to get into healthcare systems, whether it's long-term care, whether it's the government, and so on. So the way it's set up is Melanie will present, we're thinking at 10, sharp at 10. So if you want to learn more about the Navigator Program, make sure that you are on time, you are not late, and you can listen to Melanie talk and you can ask her questions. So we haven't still figured out whether she's gonna do it before class or right at the end of class. I think, I'll talk to her and figure it out. But that's happening on the coming Monday. So try to be present. It is to your benefit to understand this program. Okay? All right. Do you have any questions about this? Okay. No questions. So we will move forward. By the way, is everybody able to hear me?
Yes.
Oh, good. Okay. Thank you, Connie. Okay, good. We have one more. It's a chat window. Yes. Thank you, Kali. Okay, perfect. Good. Okay. All right. Let's get started. So as we spoke about last time, a longitudinal study is what happens to the dependent variable over time. Longitudinality generally refers to a time component. So if you were to imagine a graph, you don't have to imagine if you don't feel forced to, you can open a textbook and look for examples. So if you were to have a graph, your x-axis would almost always be the independent variable. So that would be time in whatever frame you like, years, months, minutes, seconds. If you think of something that changes over time, let's say income. So this is making the basic assumption that whenever you start your career, your income tends to be somewhat low, and then over time it increases till you get to about retirement. And then at that point, it kind of goes down or stays steady, whatever the case may be. Okay. So if you have a study looking at average income over a period of time for a whole bunch of, let's say, engineers in your city, you might see this trend. So there are many examples that you can think of that you can use for a longitudinal study. So, you know, your flexibility changes over time. If you think about physical flexibility, unless you're actively doing something to maintain your flexibility, over time, your toe touch, let's say that your toe touch test, which is a measure of your flexibility. So initially, when you start, there's very little gap between your fingertips and your toes. But over time, let's say this is in centimeters, over time it goes up and it kind of plateaus after a while. So this would be another example. Your obviously bank balance, income, number of social relationships, maybe less at first, increase later, number of debts in a community, weight loss, etc. So these are different kinds of pre and post sensitization, for example, are you sensitive to older adults or are you sensitized to people with mental health challenges? So you can have a pre and post testing over time too, and you can look at the impact of a testing over a period of time. So, you know, over time, let's assume there's annual sensitization programs. This is your time component. You can find that over a period of time, people's sensitization either increases to something or decreases to something. So your graphs can be either way. When you have graphs which have, is your X variable, which is your independent variable, Y is your dependent. When you have a graph, a linear or a curved graph that kind of increases, when X increases, Y increases, this is called a positive correlation. Obviously, the opposite, as you can imagine, would be a graph that looks like this, and that would be negative correlation. So you can think of many examples where you might have a negative correlation. So for example, number of deaths due to infectious disease. And if your timeline is in centuries, you look at the 9th century, 10th century, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. So if you look at percentage deaths of the population due to infectious disease, what you'll generally see is as food sources became more and more sufficient, as societies became better, society had better farmers, general income levels increased, there was a large increase in the reduction of death due to infectious disease. And of course, the big switch came in the late 19th and early 20th centuries when antibiotics and safe surgical procedures were discovered. Okay, so you can have both kinds of curves, basically. A comparison study is different from a longitudinal study. A comparison study is often called a snapshot. What a comparison study says is, I'm not interested in looking at a longitudinal pattern. I want to know the here and now of a certain situation. So an example of a comparison study would be, what is breakup of, let's say, chronic diseases in older adults in Sudbury? So what we're asking is, well, how many people, how many older adults, people over 65, if we make it very defined, how many older men over 65 have different chronic conditions? And your data might look something like a little pie chart where, you know, you have a large number of people with osteoarthritis. You have a significant portion with hypertension. You have some with cardiovascular disease, and let's name a fourth chronic, let's say diabetes, type 2 diabetes. What you notice in this kind of a study is you're not really trying to determine how long people have had the study and how the numbers change over time. All you're asking is, what is the status right now of the distribution of the different conditions in the population? Okay, so it's a snapshot. There are different names for cross-sectional studies. They're also, or comparison studies are also called cross-sectional studies, because you're taking a cross-section of society. But obviously, as you can imagine, there are some challenges, right, of comparison studies. It gives you a snapshot, which may, there might be several factors influencing the snapshot, and that may not be reflected if you do the study again in 5 years, 10 years, or whatever it is. So if you compare winter driving using all season versus winter tires, and you might measure a bunch of different variables, braking distance, sliding, grip on ice, and whatever you can think of, because I'm just making this up as we go along. So again, this would be an example of a cross-sectional study, because you're really not asking, well, what happens to the winter tire over a 5 year period with all of these variables, or you know, any of those studies. The objective of cross-sectional studies are essentially to investigate a relationship for accuracy. So for example, if you So when you're talking about investigating a relationship further in terms of accuracy, if you look at, let's take the example of English proficiency and employment. A comparison study can actually help you, because if you have a hypothesis that individuals in Canada with poor English proficiency have lower employment prospects, even though you may not do a time-based study, you can have multiple cross-sectional studies by having a whole bunch of survey questions administered in different cities in Canada. Granted, you may do the experiment on the 27th of February 2020 and you might get a result, and then in 2025 when you do the study you might get a different result. It still portrays a very accurate picture at the time of investigation. It also allows you to have replicates. Something that's important in several studies is reproducibility. So what happens in a comparison study is you can have, if you have a general hypothesis that you're testing, it allows you to have replicates or repeats when you apply that same question over multiple situations. So, anyway, I'm not sure what I had those notes for, but they were meant to do something. Since I don't remember, it doesn't matter. Don't worry about it. Okay. So the next kind of study is called a longitudinal comparison. A longitudinal comparison takes the best of a longitudinal study. And a comparison study. So the good thing about this is because you have both of them involved, you're likely to not just get a comparable approach. Or so for example, you also have the factor of time, which shows you trends. So let's think about a hypothesis that can be extrapolated over time. Let's say, diagnosis of chronic conditions is has been underreported in some cities in Ontario. Okay, so think about the statement. Suppose you have a hypothesis that you have a feeling that people in smaller towns, smaller neighborhoods often are underdiagnosed, which means they have conditions that don't get diagnosed till much later, or there's a delayed diagnosis which causes greater health problems. And this is a concern to you. So you come out with a hypothesis saying that this has consistently been a problem, and there is a reason why people have significantly worsened conditions without treatment when they're in rural communities. Okay, let's assume that's what we're looking at. Now, if it were a simple comparison study, you'd have a pie chart. Okay, let's just say Sudbury, which we consider a bigger city. Let's pick something smaller. What do you want to pick for a smaller place? Let's say Timmins. Okay. And typically what you find is if you look at percentage of population, and this is a pie chart, let's say this is no conditions, NC is no conditions, and the rest of the pie chart is different conditions. Now this is what you would find in a cross-sectional study is what you'd find is, and a pie chart doesn't have to be the only way to represent cross-sectional data. It can be represented as a table, it can be represented as graphs and so on. This is just one of the many ways to. But when you look at the pie chart, it's done at a fixed point in time. Now, if you were to look at different trends, different disease trends over a period of time, or diagnosis over a period of time, what you might actually have to have happen is a graph with different colored trend lines. So what would typically happen here is maybe your red dotted line is one condition. Let's call that no conditions. But because it's dotted, that is from Timmins. Then you have a solid red line. Let's say that's Sudbury. Okay. You have the yellow line, which is type 2 diabetes. We're just making this data up. So this is not real data, okay? Just so all of you understand. This is type 2 diabetes. This is Timmins, and this is Sudbury. We have different condition, third condition. Let's say cardiovascular disease. And so on. So you might end up having a graph of sorts, which, and your let's label your axes. Your axes are going to be years. So let's say 2005, 2010, 2015, 2020. And let's say this is a percentage of population. Okay, so you have the number of cases, you have per 1,000 people, per 10,000 people, or whatever your data is. So when you have something like this, this is the example of a longitudinal comparison, because what you're doing is you're not just comparing conditions and distribution, you're talking about it over a period of time. Okay, so that's what a longitudinal comparison is. I know your title says experiment, we'll talk about that in a second. I think my slide just jumped, I must have hit a button. Anyway, all right, do any of you have questions about case study, longitudinal study, comparison study, and longitudinal comparison? Are you all really clear? So we'll be solving questions in the back, and since you're all super clear, I'll expect answers. If you have questions, it's a good time to ask. If you want me to explain something again, we can do that. Hey, Courtney. The very first one is the case study. We didn't talk about case study today. We spoke about it in the last class. Okay, so we spoke about case study. A case study is typically when you're looking at a single case. So in that situation, it can be phenomenological. It can also be numerical in nature or quantitative. For example, if you're looking at the consumption of fruit juice or pop at a country club. I think we used that example last time, right? So it's a single case. You can't, just on the basis of consumption of the juice in one particular country club, doesn't mean that phenomena would be replicated anywhere. It's a single case. That's why it's called a case study. It can also be a phenomena thing where you talk to a bunch of people at a long-term care facility and talk about their experiences with, say, the recreational therapists or the recreational therapy program they have going. Again, it wouldn't be reflective of any other long-term care center. It would just reflect that one, and that's why it becomes a case study, okay? Thank you for the question, Courtney. That's good, because I'm sure, I always tell students, and this is always a good thing to remember, the only bad question is the question that you haven't asked, okay? 90% of the time. There's the 10% of the time when you can have a really bad question. But 90% of the time, you can be safe and content recognizing that if you've asked the question, it's probably a good question. So please ask. Otherwise, we'll move forward. Okay. Going once, going twice, sold. Okay, next. So the experiment is the last and final type of study that we all do. What is an experiment? Give me an example of an experiment. Any experiment. We all experiment, right? Give an example of an experiment that you may have tried.
Changing a recipe?
That's always an experiment. Not the safest one, but yes.
Yeah. Never to do before for the first time when you have company.
Yes. And how many years has it taken me to learn that? Okay, great. Thank you, Connie. Recipe change before company. So an experiment. So we experiment, and we in common parlance, we use experiment term quite freely, right? And yes, we would use changing a recipe before company showed up as an experiment. And why would it be an experiment? Can you think of why it might be an experiment? It's different. Yes, brilliant. Thank you, Marianne. So if anybody did not capture that, Marianne basically said, you're trying something that's different and you don't know the outcome of what will happen. And that's exactly what an experiment is, right? So for example, just using Connie's example, you have a tried and tested recipe for apple pie. Well, this is how much shortening you use. This is the flour you use. This is how you knead it. And you make your apple pie. All of a sudden, you decide to get a little crazy. And you say, well, let's add some rhubarb and strawberry, and let's add some marmalade, whatever you decide to do. And now, you have this predictable outcome which you get from your apple pie, which is people going ooh and ah about your apple pie with hot apple pie with some vanilla ice cream, fantastic. And now you have this new experiment where you have this apple pie, and you don't know what to expect. Right? You might be a scientist who's a positivist, and you might say, okay, I'm going to make the hypothesis that this pie will be appreciated. Okay? Or you might be more of a socio-psychological kind of scientist saying, I'm going to predict that no matter how this pie turns out, everybody's going to say it's awesome because they're being polite. Okay? So you might have different hypotheses on how this is going to go. An experiment is basically a method of always learning something. How does an intervention change something? Whether it's the case of changing the recipe for an apple pie, whether it's the case of a drug that you're using. So for example, an experiment it is tested. So a lot of testing for all the medication that you get. So for example, let's talk about the flu vaccine. So a lot of us get the flu shot every year. It's effective sometimes and it's not effective sometimes. But before you actually get the flu vaccine, what happens is that the vaccine itself is put through a lot of trials and testing. There are animal models, animals that are injected with the flu vaccine to see if the animal models will mount a response. Do they produce antibodies to it? And is it going to be effective? Because if people can't produce antibodies to the vaccine that's provided, you're not going to have protection against the flu, right? And also they like to test, well, this is the vaccine we have at hand and this is a new strain of flu that's come out. How effective is it against this particular strain? So they use different animal models, different kinds of testing to see. And all of this testing comes under the category of experiment. Okay, so for example, one of the ways they will test is if you have animals A and you give them the vaccine, and animals A become, I'm just trying to draw biceps, I'm not very good, but okay, strong. Then are resistant, then the vaccine works. But someone could argue that, well, it doesn't matter what you injected into animal A, animal A would have still become resistant, or animals A in the group A would have been resistant. So then you have to do something called a control. you take animals B, which are very similar to animals A, and you inject random stuff. Stuff similar to the vaccine, but not exactly the vaccine. And if your experiment has truly worked, even when you plan the experiment, you plan it out. So, and what you should basically have is B should have no resistance. And that's how you know that your experiment successfully worked. In our gerontological world, examples of experiments would be some kind of an educational intervention to see if people's knowledge in a certain area has increased. So for example, if I had you write the midterm exam, okay, and you got a certain score on the midterm exam, and if I had someone else who was not taking the course write the midterm exam, okay, the scores would be dramatically different because they haven't been exposed to that content. So that would be the proof that this particular content that you've been exposed to has enhanced your learning or understanding in a certain area. There are different kinds of experiments. You can do experiments that are comparative. These are comparative experiments where you have what we call control. This would be called a control. And this would be called a test. You always have to have a control during an experiment because you want to be able to say that there is a cause and effect. The only true causal relationship can be proved. Like for most things, what happens is you can't prove a causal relationship between two concepts, okay? A causes B. The only time you can do A causes B is when you do an experiment. Okay, and the way you do an experiment makes it very clear that A causes B because you control for a lot of other factors. And an example is the vaccine study. An example is being able to do well on a research methods course because you studied the content versus people who have not studied the content. This is A versus B, okay? A causes B kind of study. There are confounding factors in every experiment. A good scientist will always deal with confounding factors. So for example, if we say, well, a bunch of students taking the research method course, the class average is 80 or 85. Students that don't take the research methods course but choose to take the test as part of an experiment score only like 30 to 40%. But then one of you smart students points out, hey, but some of us have done research literacy before. I'm sure we could have gotten a good score even because of that. It may have nothing to do with the current course, right? So then we have to say, okay, that's a confounding factor. So now I have to do the test again, having some research literacy students who haven't taken research methods do the midterm, and then some research methods students have taken both courses do the midterm. So then we can show cause and effect of the new course having impacted your test marks, okay? So that's how experiments work. Questions on any of the different research designs so far?
With your last example with the test for gerontology, would you have to say, like, would there be a requirement for the students who've taken the course to have studied for this exam for it to be accurate?
So that would be another confounding factor. So what we'd have to control for is, so we'd have two groups. So that's a good question, Connie, and thank you for bringing that up. I'm just going to erase this and we're going to change this to... Okay, so let's say these are 3127 students. This is 3126 plus 3127, and these are students who have only taken 3126, which is the research literacy course, okay? And there are several confounding factors, as you pointed out. So studying for the test is a factor. So we have to make sure that if we're comparing between groups, you can't compare apples to oranges. So both groups will have to be given an opportunity to study for the exam, Okay. Both groups should have comparable students. So for example, I can't pick students who have had other research courses in their background to take the test. That wouldn't be fair. You can't pick up students from different disciplines. So they all have to be Gero students. They all have to be current students. They all have to probably be in their third year most of the time, because most of the students that do take the research methods course are in the third years. So all these control or confounding variables you'd have to control for, and a good researcher would try to accommodate for those, because the moment you start having too many confounding variables, then you can't prove a causal relationship.
And how much, how many people do you have to have in each group in order for it to be legitimate?
That's a wonderful question. That's an excellent question. For those of you who haven't been thinking about it, there is a number associated with doing any study. Remember, in an ideal situation, the best answer is all the students. Okay? And but in practicality, for example, if you're looking at research methods course, you may not get your class of 20 students to volunteer to do the experiment for you. You may only get 5 volunteers. So usually anything below 6 becomes a problem, and they don't allow for that. Or it's very hard to argue for a conclusive result in an experiment if you have less than 6 replicates. Okay, in scientific terms, it's called an N of 6. That means you have at least 6 replicates. That means you have 6 students who have taken 3126 and 3127 who are taking the midterm exam, who have studied and who are current students and who are all third year students. And you have 6 students who have only taken research literacy, taking the test, who are also third year students who have also studied for the exam and who are also current students. Okay. If you have less than 6, it becomes harder to argue, although there are statistical formulas that allow you to compensate for smaller samples. Results become harder to believe with smaller sample sizes. Does that answer your question, Samantha?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. In an ideal world, you want to get as many samples as possible. Okay, so that's this. All right. So that's the end of the slideshow, but as we always do after this, the slideshow, we go to the end of the chapter and we try to answer the questions. I need to tell them that I'm still here. Okay, very good. Okay, let's look at the first question. What basic question is answered by research design? What does research design allow you to answer?
The type of study?
Yep. And then you can go ahead and list. So we go to question 2. You can just list, if you're asked this question, just list the 5 types of study. So the second question is asking you to list the 5 types of research design itself. So the both of those questions are kind of, they feed into each other. So what are the 5 types of research design?
Case study,
thank you, Claire. Okay.
Longitudinal.
Go, Courtney. Comparison.
Longitudinal comparison.
Thanks, Samantha. Longitudinal comparison.
An experiment.
Highly, thank you. Experiment. Oh, I before we move to the next question, I have to talk about something. This is not part of your textbook, but this is important for you to recognize that oftentimes we can't experiment with stuff, but society, nature, and politicians often cause what is called accidental experiments. Okay. Accidental experiments are very, they don't allow you to control for too many variables, but you can see causality in a lot of situations. So let's take the case of an accidental experiment. Premier Kathleen Wynne made the assumption that by increasing the minimum working wage substantially, she would not only bring a lot of minimum wage earning Ontarians out of poverty, she would also boost her election prospects. Okay. We don't know the answer for whether a lot of people were relieved to get out of poverty or whether it led to more unemployment because small employers couldn't hire more people. We don't know the answer to that. But we do know for a fact that in this accidental experiment, it actually did not boost her chances of winning the election. Okay, so these are there are many, many types of accidental experiments that occur. And sometimes you see the cause and effect very clearly, sometimes you don't. Let's think of more accidental experiments that we might have encountered in the past few years.
Would you be able to give another example?
Yeah, I'm trying to think of another example of an accidental experiment that has occurred. We'll take the example of an accidental experiment that has occurred over the past 20 years. I would say 40 years. So in the 1960s and 70s, what happened is people are starting to identify fats as the primary source of heart disease. Okay. So there was a conscious move to steer people away from fats. By the time you got into the 80s, people were very militantly trying to cut fat from their diet and eat very low fat food, although the food was very rich in carbohydrate and so on. So diets increased in carbohydrate. And it was national policy in many nations to push carbohydrate-rich diets on people. This was mostly North America. This is not a European model at all. But what has happened as a consequence of that 40-year period is obesity, type 2 diabetes, and all obesity-related challenges are at an all-time high. Surprisingly, when you look at the populations before the 60s and 70s, yes, there was cardiovascular disease, but the amount of obesity was less, and obesity is a huge independent predisposing factor for a lot of these conditions. Okay, it is unfortunate that this long-term experiment has had enormous consequences. And lots of people have died as a result, but it was based on several flawed studies that came out in the 60s and 70s, which cherry-picked data to indicate that diets rich in fat are primarily the cause of heart disease. So this is another example of an accidental experiment. Okay. Yet another example of an accidental experiment would be what we are encountering right now in front of us. We continue to create carbon dioxide and burn up our fossil fuels. And whether we like it or not, there are two hypotheses. Well, global warming is not man-made, and global warming is man-made. At least both hypotheses occupy equal space in the public mind in the United States. There's less of an argument here in Canada, I believe, or I would like to believe. There are consequences. Islands in the Pacific are disappearing. So there's an experiment going on. People have decided to, by and large, the largest consumers of carbon-based fuels are continuing to burn stuff because they don't believe in it. So there's an experiment going on in the sense that they're adding all of these global warming gases. And the consequence of that experiment is going to be rising sea levels and unpredictable climate change, right? So there are a lot of natural experiments that happen all the time around us. And for the most part, natural experiments don't always have very controlled variables. So sometimes, and when you don't have controlled variables, that's when people like Donald Trump get to come and say, well, it's not completely proven. We don't have a model where there's been low carbon and everything has stayed cold, right? But there's no second planet Earth. You can't do the control experiment. And then in any case, you can't experiment with human lives and livelihoods, right? You can't do the control experiment. So it becomes an issue with natural experiments. Sorry, is that helpful or is that more confusing? And I'm fine with either response. If you said I confused you more, I'll take responsibility. Okay.
I think it's a little bit more clear.
Okay. And just think of times when people have intervened and done something and things have either gotten better or worse. Right? And they end up being natural experiments because it is an intervention that has changed or caused a change. And that's why it's a natural experiment. What question does each research design ask? I don't know that we need to go into the detail of what question. We could, but I think we just discussed that, so I'm not that crazy about doing it all over again. Why is the case study, this is a great question. Why is the case study said to be the building block of research design? We didn't talk about this, but if you have read the chapter, perhaps you can share what you learned. Why is a case study often the foundation for a lot of other? Go ahead, Courtney. Courtney has an excellent answer. I'll share it with you because I don't think she's that close to the microphone. But her answer basically is that even though a case study is for an individual situation or a case, it allows you to do a bunch of things. It allows you to ask questions that you can potentially get answers to. It allows you to test and proof your questions themselves to see if these questions are valid. Yes, the results of a case study may not be universally applicable. Like we take the example of consumption of soda versus juice at a country club, right? However, Aretha. However, despite that, it does allow you to set up the right kind of question. So for example, one of the things you spoke about in this particular country club example is we're looking at the soda machine being emptied faster than the juice machine, and we discover later that the juice machine is tucked away under a stairwell and the soda machine is front and center. Okay, so maybe because you've done this case study, you are in a position to design a new set of questions or a new set of observations where you look for where the two machines are located at different country clubs, right? So a case study allows you to test and prove questions. It allows you to reframe. If you have a hypothesis, you may have a research question, you may not have a hypothesis. It allows you to reframe hypothesis or research question. So at least these three, if not anything else, when you read the section on case study in your textbook, it will give you a more comprehensive idea, and you may come up with a couple more reasons, and that's fine. It's basically to have an idea as to why a case study is a foundation for anything. Oftentimes, what will happen is we will case studies tend to be where you start, because you don't want to go spend hundreds of thousands of dollars and a lot of time. Sorry, Courtney. Okay. It's questions are, well, let's see if I can magnify this. That might be helpful. Let's see. Not doing anything. All right. Oh, there we go. It was delayed. Okay, good. Okay. What is required to be done in a longitudinal study? So we've spoken about a longitudinal study, and I know that I can expect pretty much all of you to give me examples. But when you're asked this question, what is required to be done in a longitudinal study, how would you answer that?
Test over time.
X over time, is that what you said, Samantha?
No, I said testing over time.
Testing over time. Okay, does it have to be testing?
Making a study,
observation.
So it could be testing. It could be observations to collect data, right? So Samantha, you're not wrong. It can be testing over time, 100%. But I think the simplest answer is data over a time period. So that data could be obtained by testing. The data could be obtained by observations. The data could also be obtained with experiments to see if an intervention changes things over time. Okay.
Could it also be like secondary data from like Statistics Canada or something?
100%. So are you thinking of a specific example, Samantha?
Not really.
Okay. But I'll give you an example from Stats Canada since we brought that up. So Stats Canada is wonderful in the sense that it's a repository of gazillion terabytes of data, right? I mean, I don't have a better word for that. I don't know what the actual amount of data is, but it's just ridiculous. But basically the point is, if I want to look at the median income of a family in the city of Greater Sudbury, I can start from when Stats Canada started recording data. Okay, I can look at the median income starting from, 1900 all the way to 2020. I don't know if it started at 1900. I'm just saying that if it probably did. And that would be the use of secondary data, and it would be over a period of time. It would be, then I could graph the whole thing out, and we'd probably see an upward moving trend because obviously due to inflation, the dollar value is up and so on. Okay. Next question. What is required to be done in a comparison study?
So you need two sets of data that are similar in the way that you are able to compare them.
Okay. That is correct. So when we want to answer this question, what we want to say is a comparison study. So these are the things that attempts.
Would it be a relationship between two variables?
Yes, attempts to show relationship. Both of them show relationship between two variables. So again, it does attempt to show relationship between two variables. Between variables. It's a snapshot of the data. Snapshot or cross-sectional data. And whenever you get one of these questions, which you will, because your final exam is not going to be based on just your question banks, you will get questions from the back of your chapter as well. So it's a good idea to start framing your responses to these questions. So in a comparison study, it suggests a cross-sectional data may or cross-sectional study may or may not have a relationship between X and Y. It may or may not, okay? So for example, if you're looking at different chronic conditions for older adults in Sudbury, there is no independent variable, and there is no dependent variable. You're just collecting information on the different conditions by older adults, and that's why I made that schematic of a pie chart, because you don't necessarily have dependent on an independent variable. You have different conditions and you're suggesting a proportionality. More importantly, in a comparison study, you are comparing a variable that may be different, or many variables that may be different between two situations. So you look at disease distribution in Sudbury versus the GTA. And we don't know what these are, we're not gonna label what these are. But so you do look at how a variable changes, but you're not really looking at okay, so there is an independent variable here. So let me take that back. There is an independent variable here, and the independent variable here is actually, it's called a nominal variable. So it is either one place or the other place. That's your independent variable. Okay, so it's called a nominal because it can be nominated. Okay, so if you have five cities, so you have Timmins, and you have Burlington. So all your independent variables are your different cities, because the cities don't necessarily change. What changes within them are each of these conditions. Okay, so in a comparison study, what you're doing is you are looking at the differences at a particular point in time on the dependent variable. In the context of several different independent nominal variables, okay? So the best way to think about this is you can look at, I don't know, either income distribution or chronic conditions or percentage of older adults living in different housing circumstances, you know, whether they're in long-term care, whether they're in retirement homes, whether they're community dwelling or so on between different cities. And in that situation, your cities would be your independent variables and independent variable, and your different living circumstances would be a dependent variable, because that would depend on the cities that you're getting the data from. Okay?
I'm a bit confused with that, because when I think of independent variable, I think of it being a causal variable, like having an effect. And so is that saying the cities themselves have an effect?
Yeah, and it could be. So the cause and effect you can only really prove in an experimental design. So any other longitudinal data, even over time, because when you think about it, when you say that median income has increased over time, Even though time is the independent variable, time hasn't caused income necessarily to increase. There are several other factors that have caused people's incomes to increase, correct?
Yes.
Right? So the only research design where you can truly say that the independent variable causes the dependent variable to change is really the experiment. So in that sense, we don't want to say that to answer your question more specifically, the cities might very well be causal. There are many structural components of each city, like access to healthcare, access to resources, access to physicians, access to recreational opportunity, infrastructure and income distribution in the city, which might determine the distribution of different physical health conditions and morbidities in the cities themselves.
Okay, so it'd be better, I guess, for me to look at the independent as the thing that doesn't change, not necessarily.
Correct. Not necessarily the causal. Because the causal, you can only do it in an experiment because you can control a lot of the control variables. All the things that might confound the study, you can control for them. And that's why you want to say X is causal in an experiment where Y changes, but you don't want to really do that in others. You can just say independent, and that's fine.
Okay, thanks.
No problem. Okay, what is required to be done in a longitudinal comparison study? Well, you've already told me what's done in a longitudinal. You've told me what's done in a comparison study. And we spoke about it, so we're not going to worry about it. What are the key features of an experiment? Excuse me. What are the key features of an experiment? You can open up your textbook, no problem. Control variables are accounted for. Can be used to prove a causal relationship.
Sorry.
No problem. What else?
There is a change.
Can you elaborate on that? There is a change where?
There's a change in the difference between the control group and the experimental group.
Control group versus experimental group. So what you're saying is a measurable change is seen in the experimental group.
Yes.
Okay. Anything else about the experiment? It can lead to bad apple pie. Well, we don't know, but anyway, all right, good. So everyone's, and you know, when we answer these questions at the back of the book, don't feel shy to, sorry, go ahead.
Experiment, do we need a hypothesis that we're trying to prove or disprove?
Yes, thank you, important. Experiments often start with a hypothesis. And that's important because why would you bother experimenting if you're not trying to find anything out, right? So there's always a hypothesis, even if you don't talk about it, even if you pretend that it's all going to be fine, like in the case of the apple pie. But anyway, all right. What are the key features of an experiment? Okay. On what basis does a researcher choose a research design?
You're going to choose whatever is going to best answer your question.
Correct. It's a very similar answer to why pick qualitative or quantitative or which one's better. And you're going to basically pick a research design that best answers your question. And I think that's a sufficient answer. If I were to ask you that question, I think I would accept that. Okay, now this is important. Why is it important to control for other variables?
Because you want your results to be as close to your answering your hypothesis as possible. So you want to narrow the variables. I think you said that right.
Let's break it down.
So that we account for confounding variables?
So you want to account for confounding variables. And we're going to incorporate what you said also, Aretha. Just give me a second.
Okay.
confounding variables. But that's what they're asking. Why is it important to control for? So you're accounting for confounding variables. Aretha, just say what you said one more time. What did you say?
That we want to narrow down the variables so that we can focus on the whatever the hypothesis, the question we're trying to solve. So we try to eliminate distractions.
And possible influences as well.
Influences. I like that word, influences. Eliminate confusion. And I always use the word apples to apples and oranges to oranges, right? And it's good to think about it that way. I mean, the best way to think about it is if you are going to compare, you know, the sweetness, the amount of sugar, the amount of juice you can get out, you really want to be comparing two very similar types of apples. If you're going to pick red delicious apples and you're saying the stuff that comes from New York State is better, and or you're comparing it to the stuff that comes from Southern Ontario, you can't pick different kinds of apples, even though they're both apples, they're still different. And the reason you want to control for variables is you want to suggest, or you want to basically demonstrate that what you're suggesting in your hypothesis, perhaps a relationship, or your whatever your guess, your hunch is actually accurate, and there are not too many things that will take away from the answer. Okay, and we have several examples that we've discussed in class about this. We've discussed the example of students with comparable abilities, background, and stress levels studying for an exam. Okay, and determining that more hours causes a better result. If you don't control for the other factors, too many factors could determine, could mess up your understanding of whether the amount of study actually improves class performance, right? If you want to ask the question that sedentariness causes obesity, you have to compare people with similar metabolic rates, same gender. So in order to prevent the fact that you don't have someone who is built like an athlete and moves around and has a different activity level to someone who's extremely sedentary, and even though they consume the same amount of calories, one person ends up gaining a lot more weight than the other. Okay, so there are several reasons to control for other variables, but primarily it is that if you're looking to suggest a relationship between two variables, if you have too many other things in the mix, they will actually confuse you rather than provide clarity in your study. Next question, how does one control for other variables? Well, that's a great question.
Well, you have a control group, don't you?
You can have a control group, that is true. But let's start at the very beginning. The first step in having a study where you're comparing apples to apples or equivalent groups is to identify what the control variables are. Right? If you don't identify what the control variables are, you're never going to get very similar groups. As much as possible, you can never identify all.
And then you organize them according to similarities?
Yeah, and then you organize according to similarity. Let's take an example. We're talking about consuming calories and gaining weight. Okay? Yeah. If I randomly pick up ten students in my general class who've opted to volunteer and just split them up into groups of five and five, and then have a nutritional plan for both, and then, you know, they offer to provide information about whether they've gained or lost weight. What is the problem with doing something like that? What haven't I controlled for in this situation?
Have you controlled their activity level?
I haven't controlled the activity level because I just picked up students who volunteered. I haven't controlled by gender. Gender is important, and gender is important because of two reasons. Males tend to have greater muscle mass than females, so they burn more calories. Males also tend to have a higher basal metabolic rate in general, so they burn more calories. So you can't say that we'll have a man and a woman each consume 2,500 calories, and then we'll, that's a huge confounding factor. Activity level obviously is a confounding factor. Medications they're on is a confounding factor. What else can I think of?
Let's say you had put them on restriction because you'd like them to be at a certain weight at the end of a certain amount of weeks or months. But what if, based on stature, even among gender, even among women, some people are a more petite frame at their best, and some people are of a more pronounced frame?
So we'd have to pick people who are comparably sized.
Right, okay.
Right? That's a great point, because I can't pick a woman who is 5'11" and a woman who's 5'2" and give them the same amount of calories and expect the same outcome.
No, right.
Right? It wouldn't work. It would never work. So your biometric comparison. So the point is, you control for other variables by identifying them first and attempting to minimize the impact or influence of these other variables. Sometimes it's impossible. So then you do the study a little bit differently. For example, if I'm looking at calorie consumption and gaining weight, I may only end up with five very different students who choose to go on my specific diet, which is supposed to help them maintain weight, and five students who eat whatever they wanted anyway, because that would be the control group. Let's say that's an experiment. I might simply not be able to control for basic metabolic rate, activity level, gender, medication, etc., or the size of the person. But what I might be able to do is I might be able to study what happens when they're not on my specific diet and look at the percentage weight gain, and then put them on my diet and see what is the percentage weight gain. So for example, if it's a tall man who's 100 kilos and they're continuing to eat what they normally eat, and the end of 4 weeks they are 105 kilos. But with my plan, instead of going to 105, they actually go down to 99 kilos. Even though it's just a 1 kilo drop, considering the circumstances of what happened before and what happened after, it's almost an internal control, because but we're still comparing the person to themselves. Okay, so it's a percentage change. And if I can get a similar result in 10 people, there's a 1% drop in weight or whatever, it's consistent, and it's a percentage to percentage comparison within the group. So there are ways to control for that. But in an ideal situation, when you're doing an experiment and you're controlling for variables, you try to get people who are similar in several different ways to actually make the comparison valid. Sometimes it's not possible, right? What is done about variables over which the researcher has no control? What do?
Either you select another set of variables, or you'd have to approach the research differently. You'd have to reconsider your approach.
Oops. Okay, let me ask.
Could you just state the limitations that you have in the study? So there's going to be things that, you know, you can't account for, but you make that, state limitations.
Absolutely, 100%. So yes, it would be ideal if you cannot explain results to go and do the experiment all over again. But you have to remember this. A lot of experiments, lots of studies are massive in scale. Oftentimes, you don't have access to the same population if you've collected a bunch of interview data for them to come back and do a second interview with a new set of questions, because there are too many confounding variables in your original study. The best thing to do in such a situation is explain the data and results to the best of your ability, but identify and state your limitations as to why you got the results that you did. Okay. For example, if I have two groups of students, we're going to take the example of students and consumption of a planned diet. One set of students very similar in both ways. Both sets of students are female. They're all petite women, 5'2" to 5'4", relatively healthy body weight. One set eats what they eat. One set eats what I've given them, okay? And, or what I've planned for them. And I still find that there's no difference. And I'm stumped because now I've picked people with similar activity level, similar schedule, similar stress level, similar sleep level, and I still have different results. Or I have no change. In theory, my nutritional planning should have worked perfectly for one group, whatever their goals were. So then you start to state limitations. One of the limitations is not being able to identify a confounding factor. That itself is a limitation. Sometimes you can't understand why it might be. It could be very simple as one group of students probably drove to school and the other students walked to school. And that you may not have accounted for that in your activity level, even though you thought you did, because everybody assumes activity is going to the gym or doing something very strenuous. And it might be something simple like that, right? It could be something as simple as one set of students in general getting more average sleep per night, which changes how their body deals with calories, okay? Anyway, we will stop for now and we will finish up the questions next class and we'll move on to the next chapter. All right, have a good weekend, everybody, and we will see you on Monday.
Okay, Professor, thank you. Sorry I was so late, but the moment I got access to my computer, I still wanted to join, so sorry, thank you.
It's all good. Go through the recording. I'll post both recordings today.
Thank you very much. Bye.
Bye. Bye.
Where's my... Oh.